Good morning. Good morning. That's good. A little enthusiasm today since our weather is not that, you know, sunny. But before anything else, may I invite you again in a word of prayer before we go to our message today. Let's bow down our heads and pray. Father God, we thank you so much that you have allowed us to come over here. And Lord, we come here and we come, Lord God, to give you everything. Give our attention to you. We give all of our senses, Lord God, so that we be able, Lord God, to hear you, what you're about to reveal, Lord God. And Lord, again, there is a forecast that a tropical depression is coming down in this city, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that you protect us, protect our loved ones, protect our family. And Lord, we just pray that there will be no damages or casualties that would happen, Lord God. So again, Lord, we give back to you the glory today as we hear your message. Allow us again, Lord God, to be illumined and understand. And Lord God, it is going to be you, our teacher today. And I pray for myself that again, I'll just hide behind your anointing, hide behind the curtain of your power, and you be the one to use me, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. By the way, it's good to see you guys. Even, you know, you're wearing your jackets and probably you left some umbrellas there in the door. So why don't you say to your neighbor, it's good to see you today. It's really good. I mean, you know, it's just a matter of grace that we are here, right? I mean, we could have decided to stay home. It's gloomy weather. We could have just stayed in our bed. But anyway, we are here and we are willing to listen to the Word of God. But before we talk about the message, let me just remind everyone that our theme for 2014 is all His, meaning everything is His. Everything comes from Him and everything is His. So it's all from Him and it's all for Him. Now, last week we were talking about time and we understood what time is. That again, it is from Him and time is for Him. And we were taught by Pastor Bob how to multiply our time, and the points last week was acronym in time, T-I-M-E. I hope you still remember last week's lesson. But today, we're going to talk about talents, because there are four T's: time, treasure, talents, and temple, which is our body, which comes from Him and is also for Him. But today we're going to talk about talents. But before I talk about that, let me tell you a current event story. You know, in Cebu, today, at this day, or this day of the month, people are flocking in. You know, there's a festivity in Cebu. You probably know one who is up there right now. You probably know someone who has joined the festivity, or probably you know someone who is just there for some other reason. But why am I saying this? Because I remember when I was, you know, a little boy, that about 30 plus Januaries ago, my mother used to bring me in Cebu because she was an avid fan of the festivities there. But I, for myself, I was just there for the travel because I love Otap. By the way, I was just there, you know, just for the scenery and everything. I was just a little boy. And every time we were going there, my mom used to pack me with, my own bag. She would put on my clothes and everything that I would need, probably a cap or my socks and everything, you know, my pants and all the things that I need for the travel. And every time she closes the bag, she puts a ribbon, something that, you know, would identify our own bag. And I would ask her, why? Why would you put a ribbon in my bag? And she says, so that when we arrive in Cebu, we would not get the wrong bag. Because there's a lot of the same bags coming out, and probably you could pull the wrong bag, and this ribbon would become the identifier. Now, I was thinking and reflecting on this, and say, what if I did pull out the wrong bag? I mean, it looks the same, but the contents are not mine. What if I pull the wrong bag and I go to the hotel and open the bag and I find there stilettos, lingeries, a red dress, and probably a headband? And so, what would I do? Would I wear the stilettos and the lingerie and the red dress and go around the city I would look foolish and crazy, by the way, if I do that. But the logical and the most sensible thing that I would do is what? I would call the airport or the airport police or whatever. That I would do everything that I could recover my own luggage so that I would have my own equipment or my own things that is for me. Because that's what my mom packed me for the travel. Now, why am I sharing that, folks? Because it's also the same spiritually speaking. When we became believers, when we put our faith on the person and atoning works of Jesus, in his death and resurrection, and believing that salvation is in Jesus Christ alone, our God, the Father, our Daddy, has endowed us with a gift. A spiritual gift for our journey that we need to employ. Just like a traveler, God has given us a gift for a purpose. God has packed us on purpose for a purpose. This friend is what we're gonna talk about today. And we're gonna talk about, and our title is Employing the Gift God Gave You. Employing the Gift God Gave You. And so the main verse for today is 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. Let's all read this together so that we would, you know, capture the words of the verse. Let's already read. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. All right. So, before I proceed, let me just give you the context of this verse. Now, Peter was writing to the scattered believers at the time. The believers were scattered all over the world. And Peter was writing to all the believers because there was heavy persecution. There was heavy suffering. Not because of the empire-wide ban on Christianity, which came later, but the persecution and the suffering came because the Christians were living faithfully in a hostile and pagan world. And sounds familiar in our time right now. So, the Christians were there living faithfully, and the society was so hostile and was so pagan that they were persecuting the Christians, and persecution took the forms of slander, riots, local police action, and social ostracism. And so the readers are now encouraged to rejoice and live above reproach. And Peter wrote and gave them instructions for how they would live in a sinful world, in a sinful society that time. And so let me just bring you back a few verses before the verse. And 1 Peter 4, 7 to 10 says here, "And the end of all things is near." Now, just to bring you in context, "the end of all things is near, therefore be of sound judgment and sober spirit. For the purpose of prayer, above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaint." Now, Peter is simply saying this. You know what? Your pain, your suffering, and your persecution, it's going to end. It's temporary. Why? Because the end of all things is near. Jesus is coming soon. We are living in the last days. And that persecution and suffering is but temporary. And now, from this point on, I want you to be encouraged, and I want you to hear the exhortation that be of sound judgment and sober spirit for the purpose of prayer. While you're under persecution and suffering, and we're waiting for Jesus' return, be of sober spirit for the purpose in prayer. Next, you need to be above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. And then, he adds, and be hospitable to one another without complaint. If you want to be hospitable, don't murmur. Don't be hospitable and then be doing grudgery. Do not murmur, he's saying. And then, verse 10 says, as each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So that's the context of our verse today. Now, what is the first thing that we need to understand in this verse is this. Each one has received. Each and everyone received. All the believers receive a what? A special gift. Come on, say that with me. A special gift. All right, so for today, our points for today so that we would easily and simply understand what we're going to talk about today, I have employed again an acronym. I'm just following again the pattern for last week. Last week was time. Today, we are going to talk about gift. Very simple. Special gift. We're going to talk about the gift that God gave us when we became born again, when we were regenerated, when we got saved. And this is the gift, the spiritual gift that we have right now. Now, first of all, what we need to understand of this gift is that it is God-given. It comes from God. We need to exactly know who gave the gift first, all right? So, God gave us this gift. In an LLT version, it says, God has given each of you, not some of you, not almost of you, but each of you. Each of us has a gift, at least one. And we need to understand that. Now, let me just be clear. Everything really comes from God. You know, the air that you just breathed, you just inhaled, the burst of blood when you came in, that pumped in your heart, that comes from God. The vibration of the sound, that comes from God. Everything just comes from God. And when you were before you got saved, the skills and talents also come from Him. But they were just merely talents, and they were just merely abilities for your own sake. But from the point you became a believer, you are now endowed with a special gift by God. Same as true as when the illustration of traveling, God has packed us of a special gift for our travel. And this is a spiritual gift. And now, again, church, if God made that idea, because this is not my idea, it's probably not your idea also, it's not the idea of the theologians or the scholars, this is God's idea that He would endow us, that He would give us a gift. If that is God's idea, then I think this quotation that I just, thought is this. Giving us the gift for our own journey is God's idea. If it is from God, then it must be good. Do you agree? If it is His idea, then it must be good. It must be good, so therefore it deserves a worthwhile meditation. What this spiritual gift? It deserves a worthwhile time to reflect on and even querying in our lives what this spiritual gift is, because it is from God, therefore it must be good. Now let us have that perspective that we need to know that spiritual gift, because if we don't put value on that spiritual gift, then we don't have to talk about it anyway. Now, but if it is coming from God, then it must be good. Now, when you observe the text, it says there, as each one has received a special gift, meaning that it is already endowed. It's on the past tense. It's already given. Now, the word gift in Greek is charisma, with a root word of charis, and translated in English as grace. By the way, I'm not a Greek scholar. I just want you to know that. But we have some tools looking for the original language. And the root word for charisma is grace, or charis, which is grace. Meaning, the gift is something we don't deserve. It is given to us not because we earned it. It is not self-made. It is something that we do not really earn. It is something God's want us to have despite our shortcomings. Our spiritual gifts may sometimes not be our talents and skills before when we were saved, but sometimes God also uses the talent and skills in preparation to the gift He will give us when we get saved, or even both. Bottom line is that the gift bestowed upon us is ultimately grace. Why am I saying that? It's because sometimes when we understand that we have some skills, we have some talents, your set of skills and your abilities and your reputation and everything, your resume, and you think you can be just the person you want to be. But you know what? God has some other plans in our lives. I love this quotation from Max Lucado. He says, "You cannot be anything you want to be, but you can be everything God wants you to be." You cannot be anything you want to be. It's because you have that set of skills and abilities, and you just want to be what you want to be. But you know what? You can be everything God wants you to be. There are two characters in the Bible that, you know, really fits this quotation. And these are Moses and Paul. Let me just bring you to the character of Moses, or who Moses is. In the New Testament, Stephen was about to be stoned to death, gave his powerful sermon, and he described Moses like this. Excuse me. Acts 7:22-25. It says there, Moses was educated, excuse me, in all the learning of the Egyptians. He was schooled in the best university at that time, and he was a man of power in words and deeds. But when he was approaching the age of 40, it entered his mind to visit his brethren, the sons of Israel. And when he saw one of them being treated unjustly, he defended him and took vengeance for the oppressed by striking down the Egyptian. Okay, so one day when he was 40, he decided to go to his, you know, town of his brethren, and saw a brother, a Hebrew, you know, oppressed, and so he took the law in his hands and he killed the Egyptian. And so the next day, Moses again went to the town of his brothers, and on the following day, he appeared to them as they were fighting. The two Hebrew brothers were fighting, and he tried to reconcile them in peace, saying, "Men, you are brethren. Why do you injure one another?" But the one who was injuring his neighbor pushed him away, pushed Moses away, and said, "Who made you ruler and judge over us? You do not mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday, do you?" And so the news of Moses killing the Egyptian reached Pharaoh, and Pharaoh tried to kill Moses. So Moses fled to Midian. And as we pick up the story of Moses, he now arrives in Midian. And now the priest of Midian had 7 daughters who came as usual to draw water and fill the water troughs for their father's flock. But some other shepherds came and chased them away. So Moses jumped up and rescued the girls from the shepherds. Then he drew water for their throats. You know what? Moses, educated at the best university in the world, saw injustice. He saw an oppressor and an oppressed, and he took the law in his hands. And again, he went, and there were two fighting each other, and he was there asking them. And again, when he flew to Midian, he saw an injustice, shepherds driving away women. And so Moses wanted to be the judge, the jury, and the executioner. But God somehow had another plan for Moses. Let's go to the story of Paul. Paul was an educated man. He was educated by Gamaliel, the most respected scholar at this time. And Paul was saying this in Philippians 3:5-8. Circumcised the 8th day of the nation of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law of Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, after the righteousness which is the law, found blameless. But whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be loss in the view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them but rubbish, count them as trash, so that I may gain Christ. Paul, heavily educated man. He was a lawyer of lawyers, a Pharisee of Pharisees. He memorized the whole Torah, and he was pursuing self-righteousness. He wanted to be the best. But you know what? God has other plans for this, for Paul. God gave them the gift. When they encountered God, Moses, although he saw injustice, became the greatest hero at his time, redeeming millions of people in Egypt. Paul was committed to the death when Jesus revealed himself to him. He still was committed, and he was given that gift to become an apostle. He was given a gift that he even saw the third heaven that nobody saw except him. He was given that gift, and they become someone God wants them to be. Well, the question really is, how would I know my spiritual gift? Well, Moses and Paul, they have their own spiritual gifts, but how would I know? That's the question today. Because sometimes we don't know. And sometimes we think we know it, but it's not. So how would I know? And when we invest investigate the life of Paul and Moses, what we did is that we look backwards in their life and saw some patterns in their life. For example, Moses had a taste of justice, and God gave him the power over the oppressors of Egypt. Paul was so committed and very zealous. And what was the pattern of Paul? And when he became an apostle, he was so committed and zealous that he even rebuked Peter. But how about us? I challenge you all to read your life backward. Read your life backward. Something in your life before, God embedded something in us. Something that we really are. Find your uniqueness. Because there is a special gift for each and every one of us. And if we find that uniqueness, that unique gift that's within us, then we will find our spiritual gift. Now, in your Chronicles, page 2, come on, if you have your copy, in page 2, there is a tool how to find your spiritual gift. By the way, again, the spiritual gift or the special gift God gave us is His idea. Therefore, again, let me reiterate that it is a good idea. This is not my idea. And of course, I cannot also find your spiritual gift yourself. Now, there is a tool there developed by Saddleback Church by Rick Warren. It's called SHAPE. And it's an acronym of S-H-A-P-E. And if that helps you to find your spiritual gift, after the service, of course, you may use it. Well, let me just quickly go through it. SHAPE means, and the letter S, it means the spiritual gifts. We need to understand what the spiritual gifts are. We need to know what the spiritual gifts are. Now, let me just share to you the spiritual gifts quickly. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. By the way, the purpose why you have a gift is that it is for the common good. You need to understand, as you look at the spiritual gift, if that describes you, you need to understand that this gift is for the common good. Now, verse 8, for the one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, and to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, and to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit. And to another the effecting of miracles, and to another prophecy, and to another the distinguishing of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. Another verse that tells about the spiritual gifts is in Ephesians 4:11-12. And he gives some as apostles, some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers, for the purpose of equipping the saints for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ. And lastly, in Romans 12:6-8, since we have the gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, each of us is to exercise them accordingly. If prophecy, according to the proportion of his faith. If service, in his serving. If he who teaches, in his teaching, or he who exhorts, in his exhortation. He who gives with liberality, he who leads with diligence, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness. Now, if you look on the spiritual gifts, and that describes who you are, a little hint, then you're on the right track. Now, the letter H there is heart. What do you feel passionately about? Let me just throw in some of these questions. What were some occasions when you did something you loved to do and did it well? You know, putting the spiritual gifts and comparing it to yourself and then looking back, what are the some occasions when you did something you love and you did it so well? And you just love it and you want to do it again and again and again and again. And another is that, what have you always done well and loved to do? And this is something that you are doing, and then even though it's so exhausting and you've been working 14, 15, 16 hours, and if you're going to do it again, you're still energized. That's a hint of your spiritual gift. And we need to read backwards in our life. You know why? Because your past presents your future. Your past presents your future. You need to read backwards and know all of those things. And again, the personality and the education, and you know, the E there is very, very interesting, because now if you have a hint of your spiritual gift, you need to experiment. You need to apply it, try it. Don't stop. And if once you tried it and it validates really that that's your spiritual gift, embrace it. Say yes to it. This is my gift. This is where I belong. This is where I will thrive. This is where I will contribute. This is it. I cannot be wrong if I am myself. I cannot be wrong if this really is what God gave me. All right? And again, if that is God's idea to me and to you, it's a good idea. I love Max Lucado's illustration. Again, Max Lucado is a wonderful author and teacher. I just want to pull out an illustration from him about this. Let me read that to you. Once you know your spiritual gift, accept God's permission to be whom He made you to be. A frog can flap its little legs and never fly. Some of you have been flapping a long time, too long. Your heroes are birds. Your mentors are birds. You think you should fly and feel guilty that you can't. Enough of this bird brain thinking. Be a frog. It's okay to jump. You see, sometimes we imitate people. We copy them. Sometimes it's not us. Just like this illustration is trying to say. But if you find your giftings, if you find your uniqueness, if you find that special gift that God has given and endowed us, it's okay to jump. You don't need to fly. So, what is your gift? What is the very thing that God gave us so that we would be able to practice that gift? Now, God-given gift. Now, we now understand. Employing the gift God gave us. Now, we now understand that this is a God-given gift. This is God's whole idea, and this is a good one. And it really is worthwhile to, you know, search for ourselves what that given God-given gift is. By the way, again, I cannot tell you your gift. It's just between you and God. Now, letter I. The God-given gift has a purpose, and the God-given gift is intended for serving one another. It is not only just for yourself. It's not only for your own consumption. It is intended for serving one another. Where do I see that? As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another. That is the question, or that is the statement there. It is for serving one another. Now, how? How do we serve? Well, in 1 Peter 4:11, the next verse, it says there, whoever speaks, it is to do so as one who is speaking the utterances of God. Whoever serves is to do so as one who is serving by the strength which God supplies. Now, this is basically what he's saying. You want to serve? There are two ways to serve. If you want to speak like what I am doing today, then speak. Speak like it is the utterances of God. If you don't want to speak in an audience like this, if you don't want to be, you know, a public speaker, you can serve, you know, in another way, where you don't need to speak like this. For example, you can always be, you know, ushering. You give away those chronicles. You can join a D group. You don't need to publicly speak. There are two ways, really. You don't need to be you don't need to stand up here and say, I'm serving. And all those spiritual gifts are really classified into two. But the main purpose really is to edify the whole church. Now, let me tell you this, because sometimes we're just too big. You know, I don't want to do that. I don't want to serve. It's just too much for me. I don't want it. I don't have the ability. There's so many excuses that you don't want to serve. Yeah, joining D group, it's just too corny. I cannot. There's just too many excuses in your heart. But let me tell you this. Sometimes it's wrong, friends. It's wrong. Let me give you this. Don't be too big to do small things. Sometimes we are so inflated and that we just cannot do those menial tasks. I can't do those. You can make the excuse, I'm on the executive level, I can, you know. Friends, why am I saying this? Because Jesus, Jesus is larger than life. He's larger than the universe. He's larger than creation. He's beyond creation. He is God. And he chose to be small, to become human. He chose not to use his godly attributes, and you know, he walked here on earth and he served. And he came to serve, not to serve. He came here and you know, he did simple things. He was in the a town of Nazareth. It was a simple town. He was even born in a manger. And he even chose his team of 12 simple guys. And if I were Jesus, and if I were God, if I were only, I would choose a dream team of cherubims and seraphims and angels to minister. But not Jesus. He chose to do the small things. He chose to be interrupted by a bleeding woman. He chose to be interrupted by a Samaritan woman, the simple people. And how about us? Are we just too big to do the small things? Are we just too big and go there and say, ask, how can I help you? Are we just too big that we can't even give our smile and welcome each and everyone? Are we just too big to just say, good morning? Simple thing, simple act of kindness. Friends, don't be too big to do small things. I was talking just a while ago when we had a break in a, you know, the first and second service. And I was so blessed with this woman. She is turning 93 years old. Turning 93 years old. I asked permission that I would use her as an, you know, also a encouragement, because I'm really blessed by her. She is 93 years old. Her name is Mommy Eden. And she is sometimes right there at the door giving chronicles. 93 years old. And I ask myself, what is my excuse? And I'm going to bounce that to you right now. What is your excuse? If a 93-year-old woman can stand there and do the small things, are you too big to do the small things? Friends, it's a challenge. It's a challenge. Because the gift really is intended to help one another. Now, we now understand that gift, the God-given gift, is intended for serving one another. We also need to understand, if we find out our gift, and now we understand that it is serving for one another, you know what, friends? It's for God's glory. It's for God's glory alone. Where do we find that? You know, as each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as what? Good stewards of the manifold presence or manifold grace of God. You know, as we look at the word stewards, we have time and time again explained that a steward is a what? A house manager. A steward does not own the property or estate of his master. And he works for the master, and whatever he does, the glory goes to whom? The master. The glory goes to his, or the owner of the estate. The steward receives rewards, but he never gets the glory. The glory and the honor is always to the master, or the owner of the estate. And so friends, the glory should belong only to the master, who is our God. And we also find that here in verse 11, on the second part of verse 11, it says here, so that, you know, if you serve one another, if you now know your spiritual gift and you serve one another, and it is intended for serving one another, doing service and being a servant is in all things, God may be what? God may be what? Through Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the what? The glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Folks, listen to me. If you even plan, if you know your spiritual gift, and if you plan to help others, but your motive and your heart is for you to become popular and you elevate yourself, and that you want to be famous, you want to be prominent, and you want to climb that ladder to stardom, that ladder to being a superstar, and you want the attention of all people, friends, you're in the wrong place. You need to check your heart. If you want to serve, you need to give the glory to God. If you want to help people, you need to give the glory to God. Everything is about the glory of God. Why? Because the glory only belongs to Jesus Christ forever and ever. Forever and ever. You know, I read an article saying, you know what? Preachers, when they preach, and when after the preaching, people would say, "Preacher, what a wonderful message." Actually, the preacher failed. You know why? Because it's not about the preacher. It's about God. The glory belongs to Him. Servants and stewards do not usurp the glory of the owner. Does not usurp what the master is, you know, he deserves. I am just but a servant. In fact, as servants and as stewards, less of me and more of my master. Less of me and more of my master. Friends, you need to have that kind of attitude. Glory only belongs to God. Never, ever, ever usurp the glory, because that is a very dangerous motive. Again, church, being in ministry is not about show business. It's not about, you know, you are famous, prominent, and fabulous. It's about the glory that belongs to God and being used by Him. Now, if you have all those in mind, it's a God-given gift, and it's intended for one another, and the glory is for Him. Let's go on to the letter T for the last point of the day. Letter T is that it is to be exercised by every believer. It is to be exercised by every believer. Now, let me ask you, are you all believers of Jesus Christ? Do you believe that He died and was buried and the third day He rose again for your sins so that we'll be reconciled to the Father? Okay. Again, are you a believer of the person and work of Jesus Christ? Samot o kahinay. Are you a believer of the person and work of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Praise God. That's the enthusiasm I like. We are all believers. And if we are believers, we are called to exercise our gift. It is not for us to hide that gift. And there is an appropriate parable on that. A parable of the talents. Let me just bring you quickly on that. The parable of the talents. I think most of you have heard the parable of the talents of the two servants. Let me just bring you back to that. And before I go to that, because you know what? We need to exercise this gift because we are called good stewards. We're not only called to be just a steward, you know, a so-so. We are called to be what? Good stewards. Stewards or stewards. We need to be good stewards. And the very example that Jesus put in the story, in the parable, is in the parable of the talents. Now, let me just bring you back to that story. Matthew 25:14-18. For it is just like a man about to go on a journey, who called his own slaves and entrusted his possession to them. Sounds familiar, right? Stewards. They don't own it. It was entrusted to by them, by the master. Now, let's see. There are another three characters introduced here. Verse 15, to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, each according to his own ability, and he went on his journey. All right, let me cut you here first. Let's put it in perspective. Okay, 1 talent is equivalent to 10 denarius. All right, so 1 talent equivalent to, no, sorry, 1 talent is equivalent to 10,000 denarius. Now, 1 denarii is a daily wage of a laborer. Okay? So let's put that in perspective. For example, the minimum wage, here in the Philippines is 300 pesos. All right? So you multiply 300 pesos to 10,000, how much would that be? 3 million. Correct? So 1 talent is actually, in our context, 1 talent is 3 million. And if you're a minimum wage earner, and if you work 40 years, I made a little bit of computation, you would make almost over 3 million, I think 3.5 million, meaning one talent is equivalent to one lifetime of earning. Are you with me? One talent is equivalent to one lifetime of earning, meaning the one received 5 talents, meaning he received 5 times of what he can earn in a lifetime. Alright, so he received 1 talent, and the other one, 2 talents, he meaning he received 2 times what he can earn for a lifetime, and the other one received 1 talent, which meaning he received at least a lifetime of earning. Now, let's go on to the story. Now, the 5-talent guy, this is what he did. Immediately, the one who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and gained 5 more talents. You see, if I were the guy with 5 talents, 5 times I would earn in my own lifetime, would I still work? I won't, diba? Kasi it's just too much. That's a big amount of money, but this guy had the right perspective of his master. So he immediately worked. He took risks. He took the gift and made exploits. He applied that money and he what? Gained how many? 5 more. In the same manner, it's in the same manner as the 5-talent guy. The 2-talent guy what? He immediately worked. He did, you know, he took risks. He made exploits. He used his talent and then he gained 2 more because they have a right perspective of who their master is. Now, friends, these people need not to actually work because they have a lot of money. But they did work anyway. But this guy who had received 1 talent went away and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. The guy who received little, who supposedly was to work hard so that it would, you know, double, didn't do it. Why? Let's find out. Let's find out why. By the way, before we find out why, let's see the commendations of the 5 and 2 talent guys. In verse 19, now after a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. The one who received the 5 talents came and said, and bought 5 more talents, saying, Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me. See, I have gained 5 more talents. And so this is the commendation of the master. Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Well done. You did exploits. Now you have honored me with your fruits. Enter into the joy of your master. Same also with the 2-talent guy. The one who had received the 2 talents came and said, Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more talents. His master said, look at the commendation. Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. The same commendation with the 5-talent guy and the 2-talent guy, although they were different in volume, in money, but they did get the same commendation. Good and faithful slave, enter into the joy of your master. All right? Now the third guy, let's look at this third guy. And the one also who had received the 1 talent came up and said, Master, this is how he described his master. This is how he perceived his master. 3 descriptions here. It says here, Master, I knew you to be what? A hard man. You reap where you did not sow. And you gather where you scattered no seed. Okay, 3 things. He described his master. You're a hard man. And by the way, the hard man here is the same word when God said to the Israelites when they were in the wilderness, a stiff neck. The same picture, the slave saying to the master, you know what, master, you're a stiff neck man. You're a stubborn man. You're not a generous man. Actually, you're really a hard man. That's how he described his master. And so I was afraid and went away and hid your talent in the ground. See, you have what is yours. And so the master was enraged. And this is what the master said. But his master answered to him and said, you wicked, lazy slave. You knew that I reap and I did not sow and gather where I scattered no seed. There are only 2 descriptions that the master did agree. Of course, he's the master. He reap where he did not sow and gather where he did not scatter seed. But there's one description the master really did not agree. What was that? He was not a hard man. He was not a hard man. You know why? He gave a lifetime of earning to this guy. It was not just a one day wage. No, it was a lifetime of earning. Why would a hard man do that? He's not a hard man. Our God, when he endows us, when he gives us or entrusts us something, he gives a large value of it. And we need to understand that. We need to have a right perspective that whatever God gives us, it is good. It is always good and it has value. And it is always something that, you know, it is just purely grace. And so the master was really mad because why would he become a hard man? No, he was not a hard man. Although he really reaped what he did not sow, because he would not reap because he's the master, or he would not sow because he's the master. He would not gather because he was the master. He had slaves. And he said, then you ought to have put my money in the bank, and on my arrival I would have received my money back with interest. At least put it in the bank. At least the money had some fruit. And honor me with that, you lazy slave. You think of me as a hard man. I'm not a hard man. He actually is a generous man. And so what did he do? What did the master do to this lazy and, you know, misconception guy? And he said, therefore, take away the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10. Friends, sometimes we do little things. And even, you know, just depositing in the bank and probably earn some interest. We do some things in our life and we're thinking, there's nothing really could happen in the simple things that I do. It would not impact people. But we are called to become good stewards. We are not called to become, you know, good and flashy stewards. We are called to become good and faithful servants. We are not called to become good and creative servants. We are not called to become good and handsome servants. We are not called to become good and, you know, popular servants. No. We are called to become a good and faithful slave. Good and faithful servant. And sometimes when we think of things like, you know, I don't want to serve, I don't want to really become, you know, it does not really matter what I do, it's just too small. You know, when we were, Vice Pastor Bob and I were talking, he gave me this illustration. An avalanche, you know, an avalanche. We don't have ice here in the Philippines, but of course, I think you know what an avalanche is. It's a mountain of ice, and an avalanche can be triggered by one snowflake. You know that? I think so. The scales can be tipped by just 1 gram. There are many things, small things that happen, or there are big things that happen because of a small thing. And that's not really a waste. You know, I read a story about this guy. There were some Christian couples going through their neighborhood and they were giving bread. And as they gave bread, they heard, a couple arguing behind the door. And so they knocked on the door anyway. And so the husband said, "What do you want?" Because they were in arguing. And so, of course, "What do you want?" "Well, we just want to give you a bread." "Why? Why do you want us to, why are you giving bread?" "Because we want to show God's love to you." And the husband broke in tears because they were arguing. He was arguing with his wife, asking him, "Does God really care? We just lost our boy 3 weeks ago. And does God really care? And now we are arguing and you come in saying that God really loves us because of a simple task, for a simple act of kindness, giving a gift." Friends, we are called to become good stewards. Don't bury your talents. If you now know the spiritual gift you have, exercise it. Don't bury it. Use it for God's glory. Use it to help one another because it's God's gift. Now you're asking me, I'm just thinking, "Brother, buti pa, hindi ko na lang alam yung spiritual gift ko." In English, maybe, just maybe. I hope I didn't know my spiritual gift, so that I don't have that responsibility. You know what, friends? Again, let me just bring you back. This is God's idea. And if it is God's idea, it must be good. Right? And we need to know this, and we need to apply this, and we need to exercise it for God's glory and for serving others, so that the church, the local church here, will be edified. So the body of Christ here, the local church, will grow. It is faith really in action. Now, friends, I hope you would again leave this place with these acronyms in mind: GIFT. Again, it is God-given. It is intended for serving one another. It is for God's glory alone. I should put that there, for God's glory alone, to be exercised by every believer. Let me summarize all of these things before we close our, or as we close our service this morning. Let me just read this to you. Whatever talent or gift the Lord has entrusted to us, we are to employ them to serve others. We must be continually asking, Lord, how do you want me to use these talents that you have given me to serve others and bring you glory? Unbelievers routinely use their talents to serve and glorify themselves. But as believers, we understand that our talents are not self-made. They are God-given. So we should always remain both humble and grateful for the special gifts He has given to us, and anxious to use them to honor and serve our King and His kingdom. Church, this is a challenge to all of us. A challenge to query, you know, our lives, to query the things in our lives, and to understand and to know and to apply our spiritual gift. Where do we fit in this body of Christ? Where would I thrive? Where would I really serve? Friends, again, this is for the common good. We are not baptized into the church for nothing. We are not saved for nothing. We are actually saved to serve. And we enjoin you, I enjoin you, to join into the ministry. And the main ministry of CCF is D Group. And if you have the interest, and if you are now, you know, you understand now what God has given you, join a D Group, sign up in a D Group, apply what you have received, or what you have now know, or what you now know about your spiritual gift. D groups are great venues, really. Small groups are great venues for our spiritual gifts to be exercised. And this is the main ministry of CCF, the small group. Sign up. Don't be afraid. Nobody will eat you in a D group. What we will do is, you know, I'll tell you, you will be blessed. And people will be blessed also by you. So, again, church, as we go out of this place, I do pray that there is a challenge that is, you're bringing up the challenge in your life, asking God, really, what is my spiritual gift? Again, I cannot tell you your spiritual gift. It's between you and God. And I cannot force you to use that. It's only between you and God alone. Amen, church? Amen, church?
Amen.
That's very good. That's the enthusiasm. Let's all stand up and close this with a word of prayer. Father God, Lord, we thank you so much. Thank you for giving us, Lord God, a special gift. We don't deserve this, Lord, but still you have given us, because you have given it with a purpose. You know what we need. You know, Lord God, what we can do, because you have fearfully and wonderfully made us. You have embedded into us, Lord God, something, Lord God, and that as we have that divine spark, Lord God, our spiritual gift comes out naturally. And Lord, again, we pray that each and every one of us here who is present here, who has heard your message, Lord God, that we will be challenged, Lord God, challenged to to search for that, to meditate, to reflect, and pray that you would reveal your spiritual gift to each and every one of us. Because this is your idea. This is not our idea. And this is a good idea that comes from you, Lord God. And so, Lord, may all of us, Lord God, become someone you want us to be. Because we will be everything if you want us to be, Lord God. Lord, allow, Lord God, growth and transformation in our lives, change our minds, Lord God, as we use the spiritual gift, Lord God, intended to help one another for God's glory. And as we exercise this, Lord God, give us the opportunity, Lord God. Give us the opportunity to experiment on the spiritual gifts that you have endowed us, Lord God. Help us in this matter, Lord God, because this is from you and this is for you, for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.